The air brake system has ability to do high force braking with small input force. High pressure air is used to push the brake shoe against the brake drum. In this video, we'll learn how the air brake system does that. Air brakes have become the standard instead of hydraulic brakes, which would have much less force on a heavy-duty vehicle. So the air brake is a control system, but it isn't the immediate actuator system that pushes the pushrod. Rather, it is a mechanism to activate that actuator system. Typically, the kind of actuator system activated by a brake system is a drum brake. For example, in this chassis that you see depicted here, there is shown a drum brake system. At the tip of the brake shoes, there is a cam. If we rotate this cam, it will push both brake shoes to the outside, which will activate the brake. To go into detail, the cam is connected to a push rod. So, to activate the drum brakes, we need to push this push rod. This is the job of the air brake system. The air brake will push the pushrod with high force, resulting in both shoes being pushed against the drum with high force, which will result in high force braking. The air compressor supplies energy to the air braking system. For a deeper explanation, let's start from the engine. Here we see an air compressor. The air compressor is connected to the engine pulley by a fan belt. So the air compressor works when the engine runs. The compressor supplies air pressure to the air braking system. Now, connected to the compressor, there are three channels, an input channel and two output channels. Both output channels are used to distribute pressurized air to the air tanks. This is the high pressure source of energy to operate the air brakes. It will not be the low pressure source of air that will come through the driver's foot pedal, which we'll learn about later in the video. That low pressure force will merely trigger this high pressure force. But the air that is stored certainly has contaminants, like dust and water. We know that water is an uncompressible material, which means that if this water were to come into the system, it might break the air brake component. To get rid of it, before the pressurized air comes to the air tanks, it will be diverted to the air dryer, which will get rid of the contaminant so that it is free from water. The water will be discarded by a waste channel, and the clean dry air will be shared with the tanks. Let's look back at the compressor. The inlet hose comes from a valve mechanism called a governor. The governor functions to keep the air pressure within working pressure, which is typically 100 to 125 or 150 PSI, and not let it overpressurize. If the pressure is above 150 PSI, the valve here will close. This will close the path from the outside, but it will open the path from the air dryer, thus effecting a closed, contained loop from the governor to the compressor, to the dryer and air tanks, and back to the governor. Here's the inlet channel from the outside, which the governor will block. Here's the channel from the air tanks, which determines when the governor will block. This tank air enters a small chamber at the top, which, when it becomes overpressurized, pushes down the floor, which is a membrane, and closes the governor, thus cutting off incoming air from being sucked through the governor over to the compressor. So, whenever the tank air goes above 150 PSI, it'll overpressurize that top chamber, drive the membrane and piston down, thus cutting off the inflow valve from the outside, and instead opening up the inflow from the dryer and tank air, thus effecting the closed loop from governor to compressor to dryer and tank to governor. But whenever the pressure drops below 100 PSI, the plunger will slowly move back up as the spring pushes it. This will reopen the input channel from the outside, and the pressure can start rising again. But to determine what to do with all this compressed air, let's go to the cabin area where we see a brake pedal. A valve is located under the brake pedal so that when we push the pedal, it will push a piston inside of this valve. Here's how that works. Inside of the brake valve, we can see a mechanism. There are two inlet hoses from the tank and two outlet hoses to cause chain reactions downstream. When the pedal is not stepped on, the piston surface's side will block the two inlet channels. But when it is stepped on, it will open a path to the outlet channels. Note, the piston's position directly correlates to the amount of airflow. So if it is only pushed a little bit, only a little hole will be opened and the brake will be partially activated. But when we step on the pedal in full, the piston will open the maximal gap, so the flow activated will be maximum. This mechanism gives the driver fine-tuned control to operate the brake much or little based upon the road conditions. Now let's go from the foot pedal valve downstream to what it triggers, the relay valve, whose function is to connect the high-pressure air tanks directly to the brakes so that the brakes may be supplied with already high-pressure air from there, over 100 psi, and not have to come from the foot pedal valve's air, which is just gradually starting to rise up from zero. Thus we see that the air tanks supply both sides of the relay valve. A little bit of air, which comes to the top indirectly through the foot pedal, and a large blast of air, which comes through the bottom directly from the tanks. You can probably already imagine how it works. When the piston of the brake valve is pressed, the air flows down the signal channel to the top of this relay valve. This airflow will push the relay valve's piston down, which will open the flow from the air tanks to the brake chamber down on the wheels. Down on the wheel, the brake chamber is a component to convert air pressure to mechanical movement. The air from the relay valve will pressurize the air chamber inside of the brake chamber. This will expand a membrane connected to the pushrod. That pushrod is what we said at the start of this video is going to drive the shoes against the edge of the brake drums, thus halting the rotation of the wheel. Now, there's one more component downstream from the relay valve which we skipped. This is called the quick release valve. Now, from its outward position, the quick release valve might seem to function merely to distribute air evenly to both sets of wheels, but that's not its main function. Its main function is immediate air release once the braking is finished. When the braking is finished and the relay valve retracts, 100 psi air will be released out the bottom of the relay valve. But that's not fast enough. So the quick release valve releases air quickly in the vicinity of the wheels themselves, rather than way back by the air tanks where the relay valve is. This component works automatically once the air pressures drop. So to conclude, in an air brake system, the amount of air pressure is influencing the power of braking. That means that the pressure must reach a minimum of 100 psi before the vehicle is safely operated. That's why we always see the driver run their engine for approximately 30 minutes before operating in order to build up enough pressure to reach 100 psi. Thus ends the animation of the air brake system. We hope it adds some insight.